Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Let's Play Star Trek Online. This is the Doctor, and we're going to take a little time-traveling trip into the past. We're going to go back to Season 8, when Season 8 came out, and we're going to look at a ship that came out during one of the special featured episodes that was called Sphere of Influence, and that was the Obelisk ship that we got. It's an Obelisk carrier. I never went over that ship as in much detail as I wanted. I finally now have, I guess, a final build, but or at least a build good enough that I can show you guys this ship in combat and finally do a whole series on it. So I'm going to do this ship before we jump to the Dyson stuff. So to start out, I am going to basically go back to the Season 8 dev blog number 14 you see on your screen here. I'm going to read through all about the Obelisk carrier and all the stats, and then I'm going to jump in game and do our usual intro, show you my build, show you some PvE in it, and just show you what I can show you. If you want to skip through this introduction, which is going to be me just basically reading this webpage, feel free to do that. I'll put a note in the video so you know what time point to jump to where I go in game. But if you want to sit here with me and go over these stats, you'll know what you'll be getting out of the Obelisk carrier. The specific one I'm using is the Advanced Obelisk carrier, and that's a little bit different from the regular Obelisk. I just called it an Obelisk carrier. So anyway, let's get straight to it. This strange and powerful ship is from an ancient culture that has had limited contact with the Alpha Quadrant. Although the ship is not Ilachi in design, it does share enough similarities with their technology to have a common origin. I've always found that very important here, that the Solanae, which is what this ship is from, this is not an Iconian ship, which is often confused when people play Sphere of Influence. This is not an Iconian ship, it is a Solanae ship, and the Solanae have some kind of heritage with the Ilachi, which of course we meet during the Romulan faction. And they have some kind of history together and some kind of sharing of technology. So I've always found that interesting. All right, design notes. The Obelisk carrier is among the largest playable starships in Star Trek Online. It is an engineering-centric carrier, so it tells you right there, engineering-centric character. So what would this best be put on? An engineer. It's got a very high hull strength and an abundant amount of seating for engineering bridge officers and engineering consoles. This hulking carrier comes equipped with Obelisk Swarmer hangar pets in its two hangar bays. So I would not fly it on a science character. I would not fly it on a tactical character. Although you could, you're just not going to be getting the best out of it unless you're an engineer. And this does have the highest hull strength in the game, at least the advanced one does. So that's very important. If you want a tanking ship, you want to put it on an engineer. So now we've got the whatever I called it and an engineer. We're doing good so far. Okay. This ship can be earned by completing the Sphere of Influence feature episode before server maintenance starts on December 5th. So this is no longer available, but when it was available, you could get this for free by playing Sphere of Influence. I have the free one, and I did an intro video about that. However, that is not the one I'm going to be doing today. I'm going for the advanced one, the better one. After this time, members of fleets, blah, blah, okay, we know all that. So here's the ship details about the normal one. If you have just the free one, if you played Sphere of Influence and you got the free one, here are your stats. You have a hull strength of 43,500, which is very high. You don't have a shield modifier on it, so, you know, it just doesn't have that. Most science ships do. Engineering ships, they can or cannot. This one does not. But it has a high hull strength. It's got a large crew. It's got 3 forward weapons and 3 aft, so it's not big in the weapons department. It has, because there are some engineering ships or engineering cruisers out there that have like 4 forward weapon slots, so it's not the best. Base turn rate, of course, 5 degrees per second. It is slow as mud. Impulse modifier, 0.15. Inertia rating, 20. And that inertia always catches me off guard. I always end up running into things, honestly. Bridge officer stations, 1 lieutenant tactical, 1 lieutenant engineering, 1 commander engineering, 1 lieutenant commander science, and 1 ensign universal. Definitely built for an engineer. It has 2 tactical, 4 engineering, and 3 science. It is plus 10 power to shields, and for some reason, plus 10 to auxiliary. I guess that affects your swarmer strength, your hangar pet. Can equip dual cannons, but honestly, that's a waste on a ship that turns this slow. Hangar bays, it's got 2 obelisk swarmer hangar bays and subsystem targeting, which normally subsystem targeting is something you find on a science ship, but here's an engineering cruiser with it. Okay, and now we're going to go straight into the advanced obelisk carrier. So this is the one that I have. This is a low-buy store ship, 800 low-buys. So I did have to do lock boxes and all that to get this ship. But I got this ship to build the ultimate tanking ship because it has the flat-out highest hull strength in the game, bar none. If you want a ship that has the best hull strength, it is the advanced obelisk carrier. No other option. All right, it receives a 10% bonus to its shield and hull strength and an additional engineering console modification, and has its Lieutenant Engineering Bridge Officer seat upgraded to a Lieutenant Universal Bridge Officer station. In addition, the Advanced Obelisk Carrier comes equipped with the Reactive Anti-Proton Cascade Emitter Universal Console. So it also comes with a unique console that the free one does not come with. So here's the stats on it. 47,850 hull. Oh yeah, that is a gigantic hull, at least as far as player ships go. Shield modifier of 1.1, so this one does have a shield modifier, giving us a higher shield capacity. Again, it's going to make a good tanking ship. Crew of 3,000, 3-4-3 aft, same weapons, same device slots, same turn rate, 5 degrees per second, same impulse modifier, same inertia, but then the bridge officer stations have been upgraded. 1 Lieutenant Tactical, 1 Commander Engineering, 1 Lieutenant Commander Science, 1 Ensign Universal, and 1 Lieutenant Universal. Console modifications is 2 tactical and 5 engineering console slots. Yes, 5 engineering console slots and 3 science. Now, this does come with its own unique console called a Reactive Anti-Proton Cascade Emitter, so that takes up one of the console slots anyway. Plus 10 power to shields, plus 10 to auxiliary. It can equip dual cannons again, but it's pointless, and it's got the swarmer hangar pets. So, let's talk about the swarmers for a little bit. The advanced obelisk carrier comes with standard with 2 hangar bays of obelisk swarmers. Obelisk swarmers are armored with focused anti-proton arrays, anti-proton defense arrays, and transphasic torpedoes, and can use beam overload. Anti-proton defense arrays fire a beam every few seconds at the nearest enemy target. More advanced obelisk swarmers are capable of firing the special beam array more often. While this weapon deals lower damage than the standard beam array, it has significantly higher chance of hitting its target. These obelisk swarmers may only be used on the obelisk carrier and advanced obelisk carrier. I am using the advanced swarmers because in that same episode, you had an option to do an optional, and if you got the optional, you could get these advanced swarmers from the mission. So I'm using the better upgraded advanced swarmers on mine. Swarmers have been sighted throughout the far reaches of the galaxy, most recently in the Gamma Quadrant. Both versions of the obelisk come equipped with standard obelisk swarmers. Advanced and elite versions of these fighters, they do exist. And if you have a Spire fleet holding, you can get the elite version. So there is a version even better than what I'm running. But that requires, you know, fleet materials and all that stuff to get that. Now, here is the Advanced Obelisk Technology item set, which I am running the full set on my ship to again, get the best of this ship and to enjoy, you know, the theme of what the obelisk ship is presenting itself in the game, you know, what the devs wanted this to be like. So, of course, I'm using the entire set here. This special item set has 3 pieces. You've got the Reactive Anti-Proton Cascade Emitter from the Advanced Obelisk. You've got the Omnidirectional Anti-Proton Beam Array and the Obelisk Subspace Rift Core, which you could get from playing that same mission. Those were free. But the Cascade Emitter is not free. Remember, it cost me 800 low-buy to get the Advanced Obelisk to get that Cascade Emitter. That completes the 3-piece set. The console is standard on the Advanced Obelisk Carrier, and the Beam Array and Warp Core are rewards for completing Sphere of Influence. The console can be equipped on the Obelisk Carrier and the Advanced Obelisk. The Beam Array can be equipped on any starship, and the Warp Core can be equipped on any starship. Okay, the Reactive Anti-Proton Cascade Emitter Console. The Advanced Obelisk Carrier comes standard with a Reactive Anti-Proton Cascade Emitter Universal Console. Say that 3 times fast. This console has 2 functions. When activated, it overrides the sensors of your target and enemies near your target, forcing them to target your ship for a short period of time. During this time, your ship gains a large damage resistance and shield hardening increase, and after a short time, you will counter enemy energy attacks with a potent defensive system that fires bursts of anti-proton energy at attacking vessels. So, anti-proton based, right off the bat, we can tell that this is going to be an anti-proton build. Just no questions about it. This whole thing is built with anti-protons in mind. Omnidirectional anti-proton beam array. The omnidirectional anti-proton beam array offers a 360-degree firing arc in addition to being able to utilize the standard functions of anti-proton beam array weapons. So it's a 360 omnidirectional anti-proton beam array. Again, it's going to be an anti-proton build. The Obelisk subspace rift core is a type of advanced warp core initially discovered on the Obelisk carrier. It has a potent slipstream technology creating and utilizing rifts in subspace for rapid travel with a higher degree of maneuverability than standard slipstream drives can offer. In addition, it significantly boosts your ship's maximum auxiliary power output, and I'm guessing that's for the Obelisk swarmers. Now, here are the set bonuses. Two-piece set bonus. You've got focused anti-proton emitters, which basically gives plus 10% to anti-proton damage. So just having two of those devices will give plus 10% to anti-proton damage. Again, we're totally building for anti-proton on this. Three-piece set bonus is the enhanced carrier synergy. Activating any emergency power ability while having all three set pieces equipped causes your hangar pets to activate a weaker version of the same power. So I guess if I do like emergency power to weapons, then my swarmers will be doing emergency power to weapons, but at a lower power than that. So I guess that's kind of cool. And of course there's a unique bridge on it. So that is an overview of what the Obelisk offers. Obelisk technology item set, that's very important, that's native to it, so we'll look at that. And note, I'm using the advanced Obelisk carrier. So now, alright, welcome back everybody, it's the Doctor again, welcome to Star Trek Online. We are now in-game to look at our advanced Obelisk. If you sat through and listened to that whole introduction at the beginning of this video, you now know what the specifications of the Obelisk are, and you know what the differences are between the normal and the advanced Obelisk, and what the set bonuses are from the three-piece set associated with the Obelisk. If you skipped through that and you're just now joining me to see this ship in the game, I do urge you to go back and go over those things so that you know what this ship is all about. I will be building this ship based on that three-piece set that's inherent to it. I'm also going to build it based on the Dyson reputation system, because at the same time this ship came out, so did the Dyson reputation, and it kind of goes hand in hand in a way. And this is the first time that I'm using the Dyson reputation parts or space gear that it offers, and I wanted to integrate that space set into the Obelisk as well. Now, I think it fits more so maybe with the Dyson ships, but because I have it now, I wanted to see what it would do with the Obelisk as well. So I'm gonna bring up my ship now so we can look at the build, and we'll go over that build. Please note that I had a lot of trouble with this build because there's so many different ways I could have made it on this ship. And first of all, anti-protons was the way to go. But beyond that, there's so many different ways that you could build the ship. And the way that I'm showing you now is one way, and it's probably not going to even be my final build on it. It's just one certain way that I'm like, you know, this is working for me right now, but I may switch it out and change some things, you know, in the long run. So what is my goal when I built this ship? My goal is to have made the ultimate tanking ship. I got the advanced Obelisk for the specific purpose of having a ship on my character, or having a ship on one of my characters that I can get on and tank through everything in this game and take damage. Basically, I'm aiming and shooting for the absolute highest hull strength, and that was the advanced obelisk. So that's my goal when I built this ship. Have I succeeded? Somewhat, maybe. There's probably something better I could be doing. But anyway, here's my build. TARDIS. So there it is. I'm just going to throw it at you. There it is. Advanced obelisk carrier. Here's what I've got. I went with the, we'll just start with the deflector, impulse, warp core, and shield. We'll start with that because that's where I always start with all my ships anyway. I went with a hybrid combination of the free Solenay deflector and free Solenay hyper-efficient impulse engine combined with the advanced or adapted Mako covariant shield. That gives me the best tanking ability, in my opinion. And the reason for that is that the Solenay deflector gives me a plus 1.8% accuracy, so it's increasing my accuracy, which is always good. But it improves my ship hit points, which is your health or hull strength, by plus 35. There is no other set in this game that gives a higher ship hit point increase. No matter where it's, whether it's the adapted Mako shield or the regular Mako shield or Omega deflector or whatever other deflectors are in this game, this is the only one that gives plus 35. And remember, I'm building this ship for tanking and hull strength. So that right there sold me on using the Solenay deflector. But it goes even further than that. It also gives me a plus 35 to resisting shield drain and energy drain. Again, on a tanking ship, that's something you would want a lot of help with, is you don't want your shield strength, for example, to be stripped away from you. So that plus 35 resistance to shield drain is going to help me also on a tanking ship. And then just for bonus kicks, it gives me improvements to exotic damage, but that doesn't affect me because this is not a science ship and I'm not using science abilities and I'm not on a science character. I am on the Last Doctor. He is my engineer. Remember, this is an engineering cruiser ship. Now, for the impulse engine, I could have gone with a different impulse engine. I decided to go with the Solenay one again, because of the stats. It's going to give me plus 3.8 weapon power settings, so my weapon power is a little bit better, a little higher. That's important with a beam boat like this or a beam type ship. It increases my turn rate by plus 3. That's important on a slow moving ship like this. It does give me more auxiliary power, which is not so important, but maybe it is on this ship because I guess that auxiliary power helps my hangar. And because I'm using the swarmers and a lot of them, that auxiliary power is going to help my hangar pets. And then because I'm also using two Solenay devices, I'm getting a two-piece bonus from that, and that's called Cyclical Shield Conduits, which increases my shield power setting by plus 3.1 and my shield shield power setting 3 plus 1 and shield power setting bonus increases at low level power by plus 3.8. So I basically was debating whether I should go with a Mako here or adapted Mako set. And the one of the things the Mako and adapted Mako helps you with is your shield power and shield strength. But by going with the Solenay, I was losing that those bonuses. However, by having two of the Solenay, I'm gaining that bonus back by getting that shield power increased with the two-piece Solenay. So I really didn't lose anything. In fact, I gained more. So I'm basically, now my weapon power is being buffed, my auxiliary power is being buffed, and my shield power is being buffed just by having these two-piece Solenay things on here, the engine and the deflector. All three of those are being buffed, plus I've got plus 35 to ship hit points and plus 35 resist shield drain and energy drain. So that right there was a smart decision in my mind. And I really, really took a lot of time to go through that and figure out what would work best. Now for the shield, I wanted to go with the absolute highest capacity, shield capacity I could get. and that ended up being the adapted Mako shield. I compared all the shields, even the Mark 12 Riemann shield. I compared everything, and it was the adapted Mako that gave me the highest shield capacity. So that combined with the shield modifier of 1.1 is going to give me the absolute best shield capacity I could have on this ship. So I'm not using, you know, the two or three piece Mako. I'm instead using a two piece Solanae plus the adapted Mako. And this shield inherently has a 20% resist to plasma damage, so that's good against Borg. It also has some other abilities, like a 20% chance that any attacker that hits you with energy weapons may become placated for 1 second. So there's that. But I'm not using the set 2 or set 3 bonus of the adapted Mako. I found that it just wasn't good enough, even though the set 2 bonus, it sounds good, plus 25 bonus to torpedo damage and auxiliary power and crew resistance, that actually that resistance to crewman loss and crew recovery rate would help on this ship a lot. But I decided that the Solanae, those two Solanae pieces were better. Plus, that plus 25 bonus to torpedo, I'm going to be getting this anyway from a different set. So it wasn't such a loss that I'm losing that. And from that set, I'm specifically, it's the Dyson set here, whatever it's called. I forgot what the set is called. Protonic Arsenal, that's what it's called. I'm going to get a bonus torpedo damage from that set anyway. So I'm not losing out in what would appear like I'm losing out in stuff by not having the two-piece Mako. I'm actually not losing that, except for the crewman recovery and resistance. That would be helpful, but honestly, not as helpful as what these all provide together. So that's what I went with. It's a hybrid Solanae and adapted Mako's kind of set up there. Now, for the warp core, of course, we've got to use the Obelisk Subspace Rift warp core because I want to go for the full three-piece bonus. This is what's inherent to the Obelisk ship. It is the ancient Obelisk technology, and part of that is the warp core. So you have to have the warp core if you want the whole three-piece bonus. The second part to that is the 360-degree omnidirectional anti-proton beam. Again, you have to have that if you want the two- or three-piece bonus from the Obelisk set. And I do, so I have to have that on there as well. And the third piece to that, which you can only get on the advanced Obelisk, is this, the reactive anti-proton cascade emitter. This is the third piece to the puzzle. If you do not have the advanced Obelisk and only the free Obelisk from the mission, then you will not have this, and you will only be stuck with the set 2 bonus. You will not be able to get to set 3 bonus. But because I got the advanced Obelisk, here I've got the third piece to the puzzle. So there is what the cascade emitter does, and we can go to the bonuses. By having two of these pieces, we are increasing our anti-proton damage by plus 10%. And the three-piece bonus is when you activate any emergency power ability, your hangar pets will also activate a weaker emergency power ability of that same type. So that's kind of cool. So now I have the whole set. I have what makes the Obelisk unique, and that's the ancient Obelisk technology. So I have the whole thing on here. This is good. This is what I wanted. I wanted to test. I always build my ships theme them like you would think they would be themed. Basically, I'm theming them to their native abilities, to their native species, to their native construction and what they're meant to do and meant to be. I want to theme it to that. So obviously, I need to use the whole ancient Obelisk technology build. And so there it is now. I have that. Now, what else have I gone with on this thing? Well, I didn't have to do this, and in fact, I might be better off not doing this, but I decided to go ahead and add in the three-piece Dyson reputation space gear. And the reason is because I had just hit Tier 5 when I built this ship on the Dyson reputation, and I wanted to get that space set it comes with, and I wanted to try it out for the first time. So this is the ship that I literally tested those space items on. And so I just left them on this ship and said, you know what, this is kind of cool, it's working right now, so let's just go with that and I'll show you, that way I can show you guys what those things also do in this video. So it's a 2-for-1. You get the Obelisk carrier and the Obelisk set, and now you also get the Dyson reputation set, and it dices and it slices. Yeah, so it's almost like an infomercial. But seriously, now I can show you both of these sets at the same time. So what's the Dyson space set consist of? Well, first let's start with the console. This is a universal proton particle stabilizer, okay? This is going to give me plus three weapon power settings. So there's two items now giving me higher weapon power setting. So my weapon power is up from its base a lot. This is also going to increase my engine power setting, which is important on a carrier ship because you're moving so slow to begin with. So now you can see all of my pieces together are buffing weapons, shields, engines, and auxiliary. Everything is, all my power levels are being buffed by the sets that I have chosen. Isn't that incredible? This also improves power transfer rate. Again, that's important when you're firing a lot of beam weapons. I don't have a whole lot of beams on this ship, but it still helps. And then this also improves proton weapon damage. Now, the Obelisk carrier is built with anti-proton. It does not have a specific proton weapon. But if you get the Dyson proton weapon, then that proton weapon damage will help with that weapon. And I do have that. In fact, let's go straight to it. This is the experimental proton weapon, Mark 12. This is from the Dyson reputation. This thing is awesome. I love this. Now, it does have a more narrow firing arc than a beam. It's a 180-degree target instead of a 250-degree for beam weapons. But it is wider than a cannon. Cannon is like 45. This is 180. But the benefit of this is that it can fire like cannons. It can fire like a cannon or it can fire like a beam. That means you can use beam overload, you can use fire at will, you can use a cannon rapid fire on this thing. Yes, cannon rapid fire. So it can fire like a cannon, it can fire like a beam. It's a hybrid weapon and it's completely awesome. But it does do proton damage, not anti-proton. So the plus 10% anti-proton I'm getting from the Obelisk set is not helping this weapon. However, the extra proton damage from this console is helping that weapon. So there are different energy types, and typically you don't want to go with different energy types on a weapon. You want to stick with one energy type and just buff that. But it's getting a lot harder now to do that on builds because of all these special proton weapons they have coming out, and there is no console right now, no tactical console that boosts proton damage, only anti-proton or something else. So what you end up having to do is build like a phased polaron or a protonic polaron or something like that, and then you boost your polaron damage with tactical consoles, and that's about all you can do if you're building, you know, a proton-based kind of thing. So it's kind of convoluted and very hard to understand. It's taken me a while to understand how to get the best out of proton weapon damage. But anyway, this ship is not about proton weapon. This ship is about anti-protons. We'll talk more about buffing proton damage when we do the Dyson ships, because on those ships I'm going to be trying to build a proton build, basically. Okay, so anyway, this thing is cool, and it has a two-piece bonus when you have two things installed, and I do. I have the proton weapon and I have the console. And then the third piece, if you want it, which I recommend, is the gravimetric photon torpedo. Again, this is the third part of the what's called the protonic arsenal set from the Dyson reputation. This is an awesome torpedo. I recommend this just anyway. Even if you don't have the other Dyson space gear stuff, I recommend this gravimetric photon torpedo. It's sweet. It does a lot of damage, and it has a 33% chance of upon detonation creating a 1K radius gravimetric rift for 3 seconds that deals kinetic damage to any who enter. And I find that gravimetric rift works all the time. I mean, I will fire this torpedo at ships and all the time it creates a gravimetric rift. So it may say a 33% chance, but I swear it does it more than that. This torpedo also gives a plus 6% critical chance on the increasing your critical chance as well. So that's good. This is a torpedo that I love. And it's also part of the whole Dyson Protonic Arsenal set. So what do you get out of the two-piece and three-piece bonus for that? Well, the two-piece bonus is called Arsenal Synergy. And this is where I was talking about. I will get more photon projectile weapon damage. I'm getting plus 22.9% photon projectile weapon damage from having two of those pieces on. So I don't need that Adapted Mako set, set two bonus, which was called Tactical Readiness. That was plus 25 bonus to torpedo. Now that applies to any torpedo, so there's an advantage there. But I'm still getting almost that out of the two-piece set of this with my gravimetric torpedo. It's going to increase my my photon projectile weapon damage. So it kind of makes up for it. No loss there, really. Also, it increases my critical chance even more, plus 3%. So my critical chance has gone up even more. And this enables a usage of beam fire at will with the experimental proton weapon. So when you have two of these pieces on, you can have beam fire at will and it will work with that experimental proton weapon. Now the third piece, if you have all three of them, which I do on this ship, is called particle stabilizers. You have a plus 10% critical chance with photon projectile weapons and a plus 10% critical severity. So again, increasing my chance, and this time also my critical severity. And it enables the use of cannon rapid fire 3. So if I wanted to have cannon any cannon rapid fire, really, if I wanted to have cannon rapid fire, I could have that, and this experimental proton weapon will work with that. It'll go pew 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 pew. It's really sweet. So it's very flexible. You can use this thing, you can use this proton weapon on a cannon build or a beam build. And either one you use it on, you can use those special abilities with it. That's what makes that proton weapon awesome. Now, the reason why I say this could maybe not be the perfect build is because you are losing one of your slots for like another anti-proton beam array. Because this build is not really buffing anti-protons, not really buffing protons, it's really all for anti-protons, you're kind of losing out maybe on that. Although that's higher than the one, see these, the three P, or the Solanase, I keep forgetting all these, so too many names, too much names, the Ancient Obelisk Technology set with the focused anti-proton emitters is plus 10% to anti-protons. And this, I was just noticing, is plus 13.1 to protons. So actually, this is a little bit higher to protons than that set is to anti-protons. So maybe it's okay to leave it on then. So maybe you're getting the best of both worlds there. I don't know. That's up to you. I like this build because it's showing off all these abilities, and I can show them to you all at once now. Of course, for my beams, I went with anti-proton fleet beams, so that I can get the best DPS out of them. Very important, because I don't have a whole lot of beam space. You know, I don't have like a fourth slot, which would be nice. I don't have a whole lot of beam space, so you know, I had to go with the fleet weapons for the best punch there. And then of course, I always like to have the kinetic cutting beam combined with the universal assimilated module, because the set two bonus on that is the Omega Weapon Amplifier, which is a chance to increase your weapon power. So I always go with that on any ship anyway. So anyway, these are both of these are 360 degrees, so that means when I'm firing forward from my carrier, this beam will be firing forward, this beam will be firing forward, this beam will be in this beam. So I've got four beams firing forward. When I'm firing from the side, I'll have even more, I'll have five. I'll have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Maybe not this one because it's a little bit narrower. It's 180. Depends how I'm turned. If I'm kind of turned to a 45 degree angle, I can get most of my beams on them. If I'm turned directly at their side, this one probably won't make it, but the rest will. So anyway, that gives you an idea. Kind of on a carrier, you really have to fly it differently than other ships, a lot differently. Okay, now for the rest of my consoles, keep in mind I'm building this for tanking. So for tanking, I have a console engineering enhanced RCS accelerator with hull HP. This improves my ship hit points by plus 10.6, and it's going to increase my flight turn rate. And I have the neutronium alloy with plus hull HP. This is going to improve my ship hit points again by plus 10.6 and give me damage resistance, kinetic, and all energy. So two consoles that are buffing my ship hit points combined with this console that's giving me plus 35 ship hit points. You can see where I'm going with this ship, right? And EPS, gotta have EPS. Two shield capacity modifiers to get my shield capacity as high as I can. And I would have a third one, but of course this has to take up a slot. And then to increase my damage, anti-proton damage, tactical vulnerability exploiters from the fleet spire. And my hangar pets are advanced obelisk swarmers. These were also obtainable in the mission. You just had to do an optional to get them, but they were free. Now there is better out there in your fleet spire. They have elite, they have hangar elite obelisk swarmers. So there is better, and I could do that, but I don't have the resources right now. Once I get the resources, that goal will be to replace these with the elite ones. Then I'll have even better swarmers. But right now I'd have the advanced ones, so middle of the road. That's my build, folks. That's what I put on here. That's what I got. I'm not saying it's the best, and it can. And depending on how you want to fly the carrier here, you know, depending on how you want to build it, it can be totally different. I built it for tanking, but even then, there's probably some modifications I could make. You could build it for DPS. You could build it for doing other things. You would obviously change a lot of things if you're doing it for different things. I built it for a specific purpose. But I also built it to show you so that I can show you guys the full three-piece set of the obelisk plus the new three-piece set from the Dyson Reputation. All right, let's look at my buffs here. All right, here's what I got. Obviously going with the Commander Engineering Station, I've got Directed Energy Modulation 3. I'm sticking with Emergency Power to Weapons 3 because it is that's going to really help my weapon power a lot. Engineering team 2, emergency power to shield 1. And now if I was really building it for the ultimate tank, I would kind of reverse that, I think. I think I would probably go with emergency power to shields 3, not emergency power to weapons 3. But I don't want to mess with that right now. Honestly, I just really don't want to mess with it. But I think if I were to edit this some more, I would probably go with emergency power to shields 3. Or maybe engineering team 3, probably emergency power to shields 3, you know, to get that up there, because that's going to be more important on a tanking ship. And I was able, because this has a Lieutenant Commander science station, which is really nice, you know, most ships on the engineering side would not have, or most cruisers on the engineering side would not have a Lieutenant Commander science, so this is nice. I was able to do Hazard Emitters 3, I got somebody to train me in that. And that's going to help a lot. Again, that's a very good ability to help me with tanking right there, is that Hazard Emitters 3. It's going to give me ship hit points over 15 seconds, and it's going to do all damage resistance rating, and it removes hazard debuffs. So Hazard Emitters 3 for the win on this thing. Also went with Transfer Shield Strength 2 and Polarize Hull 1. So all that's pretty tanky stuff right there. Beam Fire at Will 2 because it's a beam ship and tactical team. And then I got Torpedo High Yield 2 and Torpedo Spread 1. And then I've got Emergency Power to Engines just so I can move a little faster because it's a carrier, it's big, it moves slow. So the only thing I would probably change here would be to reverse the Emergency Power to Weapons. I had this on a different ship build, that's what it was. And on that ship build, I liked having the Emergency Power to Weapons 3. But on this ship build, because it's a tanking ship, I would probably switch that around. But for right now, I'll leave it because it works. It's not bad, it's not terrible. Okay, so that's my build, folks. Hope you like it. I know I do. Let's go real quick and show you what's available in the ship customizer. There's not a whole lot you can do to customize this ship. Nothing you can change with the hull. All you can do is change the pattern if you want, you know, one of the patterns on it. You can't change the bridge because it's a custom bridge. There's only one material type. So really, there's no way to customize the ship. I'm a little disappointed in that, to be honest with you. I would have liked, while the patterns are nice, I would have liked to have some different materials for the ship. That would have been nice. A few different materials to choose from would be really, really sweet. And for some reason, I don't even get my veteran material on this ship. I'm a veteran. I have that special veterans material or whatever it is. But I cannot get that on this ship, and I'm a little disappointed in that. I would like that option. So I'd like a little more customizability out of it, but there's not, unfortunately. Okay, before we go into space, I know I always forget this, so let's do it right now. Let's go to the Starship Bridge. Let's explore our Obelisk Bridge, which is unique and looks very Solanae. I'm not sure that I like it. Like, if I were going to fly a ship in real life, I don't think that I would like this bridge. I think I would really get tired of it fast. But it is unique, and that's one thing that they don't always put on these ships are unique bridges. So when they do, I definitely am giving them kudos for that. I wish they would have a unique bridge with every ship. And we just have to wait. The load time sometime unloading these bridges is very long. I apologize for that. Okay, here we are. So, it's cool, but what it feels like to me... See, there's no windows. I don't like a bridge without windows, and the reason why, because I feel confined, claustrophobic. I don't know what's going on outside my ship around me. Although, I have said that having a bridge inside the ship protects you more because the enemy cannot target on your bridge. But I really like having windows to space. If I'm going to fly a ship in space, I want to look out a window. That's just me. Anyway, and also, the bridge consoles are really far apart from each other. People are really spread out on this bridge. It's like the captain in his chair would have to like scream out and like, this guy over here is my Breen, like, yo, hey Breen, can you hear me? Yeah, hey, how are my shields doing? Are they up? What's my power at? Yeah, see, that's gonna get annoying after a while. These guys back here, they'll probably never hear me. I can contact my duty officers here. I can access my library files. I mean, these consoles are twos. People can't talk to each other. Access account bank. Well, that's cool. You can your account. I just realized that was my actual account bank. So yes, you can access your account bank from this bridge. That's nice. I don't have to go to anywhere to do that. I can do it right from here. I didn't know that either. Select my small craft from here. She is scanning a hologram, apparently. I like this. This is nice and sweet. Now I'd like to see that on a bridge, but it's a little too big. It's a little too big. It needs to be scaled down a bit. And then, for some reason, I've never understood this. This is not water, by the way. This is a force field. And I don't know why that's necessary. And then this is the captain's chair. And, oh, I just noticed, I don't even face the front of the ship there, I guess. I face this way. So, that's weird to me. Well, maybe I'm at the back of the ship. So maybe this is the back, and that's the front of the ship. I never looked at it that way. I guess that's probably how it's designed. But I don't get the need for this moat around the bridge officer's seat. And it's a force field. If the force field goes down, you just fall into a hole. Maybe that's to protect me, but then if it were to protect me, I still have this bridge crossway here. So I don't know. And my panel is so far away from me. Look at this. I can't even reach it with my arms. I have to like stand up to reach the console. And this chair looks so uncomfortable. That is a terrible chair. I mean, that looks like it's gonna hurt. So I guess that's my view screen is right here, and there's like a big hologram, and you can call up a view screen and all that. That's kind of nifty and all, but I just think the space is too big. Everyone's spread way too far apart. And I guess that's all I can do from here. I haven't tried this door. I don't think it goes anywhere. Nope. So this is it. This is what you get with the obelisk, either one of them. Now let's head to space and take a look at it. Alright, here we go. So, here we are in space. Now, this is one of the largest ships in the game that you can fly. So, it does dwarf all other ships, except for maybe the Scimitar. It does dwarf all other ships in this game. And it's huge. You have to zoom way out. That's the only thing with it. But, of course, zooming out, you get to see more anyway. People that looked at this ship when it first came out made... analogies with the Ori. If you've ever watched Stargate SG-1, the series, toward the end of that series, a new ascended race was shown, and their ships were kind of maybe similar to this. This line with that circle, and like it's kind of Ori-like. Not completely, though. The Ori had a big circle-y hole in their ship. But it's kind of similar. It would look like a ship the Ori would build. Let's put it that way. It looks like a ship the Ori would build. But anyway, that was the comparison back then. And probably still is. Let's move it away from everybody here. We can take a better look at it. So this is how it turns. Now remember, I have an RCS accelerator on it right now. So this is with the RCS. With the RCS, it's not so terrible. Now without that RCS, it's terrible. But with it, it helps it a little bit, definitely. I love this coloring that they're using. They're using this on the Dyson ships now, and this obelisk. The obelisk was the first to have this kind of, I don't know how, it's kind of like ultraviolet color. Maybe that's the description. It's an ultraviolet color and it goes to black. That, I think, is a really, really cool looking color palette they've chosen for this ship. Also on the Dyson ships. You can see the little windows or little things light up blue here. That's neat. It's got, again, that kind of darker, rich, ultraviolet-y blue for the engines and everything. It looks really nice in that regard. I like that color. I like it a lot. It's the whole this ship is shaped kind of funny looking, but it actually flies pretty well in space. It's very unique looking. Definitely unique looking. Now you can take. I think I have the. No, I don't have the visuals on. So this is what it looks like natively. This is its native look. Let's zoom in. The patterning on it. See these little swirls in it. That reminds me, again, of Stargate, and specifically the Goa'uld. They have, in their technology, if you've ever looked at Goa'uld technology, actually, this may actually not be Goa'uld technology, excuse me, they always retrofit their stuff from other stuff. It may actually be ancient technology that first developed these swirly patterns. But these swirly patterns, you will see that in the show, in the technology showed on that show. I think, yeah, it would be ancient technology. But the swirling kind of lines on the hull, especially right here, you can really see that lit up right here. That reminds me of that. Again, I think that's a comparison. So I don't know if the creators of this ship and the whole Dyson thing, you know, were channeling Stargate when they made this, but it resembles some things from the show anyway. That patterning just it looks so like Stargate to me. Anyway, very detailed. I like the layering of the hull. That's really nice. Really differently shaped, though, because I guess you live in this part of the ship. And this part of the ship. And the middle is like a superstructure that holds it all together. But how do you get between this section and this section of the ship? I imagine there's like hyperspeed... there's got to be some system to get between both halves of the ship, right? I mean, there would have to be, so some kind of anti-gravity kind of thing that would, you get in a car and you head between the two sections or something, you know? Because there would have to be. Plus, I would think there might be living space down here, unless this is just simply all engine down here, which I highly doubt. There's got to be some kind of quarters or some kind of way to get down in here to do maintenance and stuff. So there would, again, need to be ways to get down there. But definitely on these sides, this is probably where everyone lives, here and here. But you would need to get between there. And I can't see an obvious way because you've got this big energy beam thing going right down the middle. And they don't connect. The only places it could connect is back here in the back. Because all through here, you know, it doesn't go all the way through. It's separated. It's separated all the way through until you get right here. So if you were going to get between the two areas, I guess you could have a car or something that kind of travels through around all this and comes back here and then all the way back through. Or maybe they just use transporters and they just beam across. I don't know. But I thought about that. You think about these things, you know. Anyway, my power levels. You'll notice my shield strength, 91, very high. Again, I built this for tanking, right? So I would want a very high shield power setting. And my weapon power is 125, is maxed out. My auxiliary is not terrible, 55, but it could be better. 46 on the engine is pretty high, so I'm gonna move well for a character. Oh, great, server not responding. Where's that coming from? So I'm probably going to be dropped from the game any second now. Yep, and I'm dropped. All right, well, I'm gonna pause the video and hopefully I can get back in the game. Hey everybody, I'm back after 2 hours. I'm finally able to get back into Star Trek Online. Ends up it was a internet problem on my end. Internet went down for a whole 2 hours. That was not fun. So here we are back on the Obelisk, and I believe I left off looking at our power levels, and I was noting my power level on shields is very high, 91. Again, keeping in mind that I'm building this as a tank. That makes perfect sense. Let's look at our stats. So, remember I said I was building this thing to be the ultimate hull tanker? 74,374. That's right, folks, 74,374 hull. That's incredible. Remember, I'm getting plus 10 hull here, plus 10 hull here, and plus 35 hull here. Also, under my reputation, under Nukara, one of these is plus 5% hull. It's not much, but hey, it helps. So there's that. One of these is also, defense. This is giving me plus 11 shield performance, structural integrity, plus 11, and hull plating, plus 11. So all these things adding into my hull strength. So that's a very high hull strength. Remember, you can only get this with the advanced Obelisk carrier. It's got the highest base hull in the game. So if you want a tanker ship, this is the one to start with. My shield capacity is 16,610. It's not the highest. In fact, I've got a ship where with only two of these, I have like 21,000 on the shield. So I'm a little under on the shield capacity, but it's the best I can do on this ship because the shield modifier is only 1.1, which is kind of low. Science ships have a higher shield modifier. And then my resists are at 31%, so not bad there. Attack, I've got a crit severity of 85%, which is pretty high. Bonus accuracy of 26. Crit chance is only 6%, a little low, but not terrible. Let's go to impulse. My full turn rate with all the buffs and everything going, I've got 8 degrees per second. Remember, this thing was 5 degrees per second base, so three more per seconds. And this is how it turns right now. This is with the RCS. So as you can see, it's not fast. That's why beams, and especially those two 360 degree beams I have, really will come in handy on this type of ship. But what this ship is really excellent for, or excels at, or with, or for, or you actually need, are these obelisk swarmers. Without them, this thing's not going to do much damage. So pop one, pop two. You can see them pop in there and they'll come out. There's lots of them actually with two hangers. There they go. There they all come out around me. One, two, three, four, five, six. So there's six. One, two, three, four, five, six. So there's six of them out there right now. The good thing is, as this cools down, which as you can see is a very short cooldown time, I can pop more. And I believe, I don't know what the total amount is, but we'll find out here right now. So I got 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So I've got 12 out right now. Is that the deal? Wow. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I'm probably skipped some. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Yes, there you go, folks. 12 obelisk swarmers out at once. I believe that's the maximum. So that shows you that this ship, that's what it's built for. If you want to do damage, you get all 12 of your obelisk swarmers out there. Yeah, because it says each hangar supports 2 deployed wings. So there you go, 12 total obelisk swarmers at a given time. That is what you can do, and that is what you need to do damage with this ship anyway. So they'll follow you, they'll do their normal thing, and that helps. And when you have all 12 deployed, using that cascade emitter, which I can't use right now because I'm not in battle, the reactive anti-proton cascade, will really come in handy. You can see them all swarming around me now. Very, very nice. Very cool. They also have that same coloring of my engines here, which I like. There, look at that. Look at that formation. Isn't that nice? Isn't that nice? I mean, that's pretty cool. I just wish they were a little... Well, I don't know what I wish. Actually, I kind of like them the way they are. I wish I had the elite ones, that's all. I have the advanced ones, so at least it's better than the base, you know, standard ones you get. But I don't have the elite ones from the Fleet Spire yet. Boy, I want those, because then it'll be a whole lot better. Let's see what the, see the hull on these, they can die really easily. See, 1800 hull, so they may not last long, but you can keep deploying them and the cooldown is really short. So that's what this ship is built for. It's called a carrier for a reason. It's a carrier of swarmers. So there you go. All right, now as for my other powers built in, really there's nothing else special. These are the obelisk powers, is the swarmers and then the cascade emitter. There's no other special powers to the obelisk ships. That's its native powers and abilities, and that's all you get. As for the other thing I have, like the gravimetric photon torpedo, it has a great high yield ability and a spread ability, but I love the high yield ability. It's the best on it. The proton thing, it works with anything I use. It'll work with fire at will, which I'm using, so it'll do its thing. I don't have cannon rapid fire on here because I'm not using cannons. So it's a waste to put that power on here. So you'll see the proton weapon fire with the fire at will. And then this is just to help both of those and to give me my 3 set abilities. So there's really no special activatable powers that are included with that Dyson reputation space set. By the way, the one I was talking about, I know I didn't show it before, is under Dyson Joint Command. Once you hit tier 5 and everything's unlocked, you go to space gear, and then that's where it is. The proton particle stabilizer, proton weapon, and the gravimetric photon torpedo. Now, I also do have the whole Dyson space gear, the space set, or maybe I don't have it. Yeah, Dyson deflector, Dyson regenerative shield, and all that, and even the Dyson combat engine. I looked at all that. I that's why they're all in my inventory here still. I compared everything, and really the 2 Solanae things and the adapted Mako was the best way to go with this thing. So that's my build. Hope you like. I know I do. Now let's go take it into some PvE and see what we can do here. Should be interesting. I'll show you the slipstream, because that's also with the subspace rift core that allows really fast slipstream, 32.89 right now. Also, it allows you to turn better while in slipstream, but I never end up turning in slipstream anyway. ship looks good. Like I said, it's one of the biggest ships that you can play in the game, so the way that you play this ship has to be different from other ships. You have to treat it really like a slow-moving cruiser, which is what it is, basically. You have to do side shots a lot. Don't worry about pointing your front. You're going to be using or relying on your swarmers a lot. The fire at will is going to help you a lot. So it's just you gotta think about what it is. And as you start taking more damage on one side, turning around and all that kind of stuff, you know, you just gotta kind of feel it out. It's a lumberer for sure. It's a lumbered vehicle, but anyway, so I'm just gonna do a couple
Jolan
of
true. We must security Jolan.
Of our Tau Day. We'll just do the two ones that I always do or that I've been doing in the past on these videos. Works out good for showing these ships. The first one deals with the Romulans here, so we'll go do that. It looks good flying in space. I mean, like I said, it's shaped a little odd. You know, it's shaped oddly, but it kind of, because it's angled downward, but it still flies pretty straight, and as you're from behind it and as you're flying it around and stuff, it doesn't feel awkward. Some ships really feel awkward. This one, it doesn't feel too awkward. It's just slow, and you just have to deal with that slowness. And the largeness. Oh, and the inertia. That inertia gets me every time, because I'll go in full impulse like I like to do with my ships, but then I can't come to a stop with this thing. It'll keep flying into the other ships and stuff. So I really have to watch it. Now, before I go hit their field of firing, always launch my fighters.
Warning, ship is under attack.
And when it cools down, I'll launch the other set. Here's a torpedo spread with that gravimeter. Now, it's only torpedo spread one, so that's not impressive. But there's the rift that forms from that torpedo. I'll use the high yield when I can, and the high yield of that torpedo is really awesome. See my turning here? I'm trying to turn around to head toward them, but I can't turn. That's the turn rate. There's the proton weapon. It's the white one. Here goes the high yield. Heavy gravimetric device 2. It's a little slow, but when it hits, it's pretty cool. And it will do that rift every now and then, too.
Target shield has failed. See
my swarmers, they're doing their job for sure. There's that rip from the torpedo. There it is again. See, it does it a lot. Now, on this last group of enemies, we're not on the last group yet, never mind. I was gonna say in the last group we'll do the cascade emitter so you can see it. As for my hull strength and everything, you can see I don't really have to worry too much about anything, about healing myself. Basically, don't have to worry about healing. Okay, we'll let my swarmers get all up on these enemies. You know what? They're going to go down fast here, though. Cascade emitter. Let's go ahead and hit it, but I know they're going to go down fast. Alright, cascade emitter's going. Ability is charging up. When it hit, there it goes. And there it goes. So that was the cascade emitter. And that was, they were all easily defeatable. The only thing I'm noticing is my crew does go down a lot. Having that full adapted Mako set, or that two-piece, it was a two-piece set of the adapted Mako would help with crew bracing and all that stuff, but not really a huge problem. You can see my hull strength was pretty high the whole time. I really didn't have to heal, I just did my rotate shield frequency for my engineering ability, but I didn't have to do any shield healing or hull healing for any of that. And I basically lumbered around real slowly trying to show you the abilities, and I wasn't really worried about them doing much damage to me. I was taking a lot of damage for sure, but I didn't have to worry about it. It was like, you know, all right, I can just sit here and demonstrate things and not have to worry about dying. Now on this one, I won't say much. I'm going to go and try to do this just like the other ones, do it as fast as I can, go all out of my abilities. Hopefully my cascade emitter will cool down. I want to use that again. It's a very, very cool looking ability. Now it's got a 2-minute cooldown, so we'll see.
Warning, ship is under attack.
There's that inertia again. I always get me into trouble.
Target shield has failed.
Go nice and easy. Wasn't worried about my health or anything. I haven't had to use transfer shields or engineering or hazard emitters or polarized hull, not in these battles anyway, because that's real easy. real easy and simple with a whole strength and shields like this. Now the Borg, they will be a challenge. You know, Tholians, they like to do energy drains. The Borg, they really like to do stuff to your ship. And then the Voth really shouldn't be too hard. I should be able to tank the Voth pretty well. But yeah, it'll be the Borg and the Tholian. Anything that'll drain my energy is going to take that away from me. But anyway, that's just a little preview here of our ship in combat. Of course, the next video will be the Borg Elite STFs. And then the second one after that will be the Voth Elite STFs. But now you've at least seen the abilities in action and what they do, and there's not a lot of unique ones. Again, the only unique abilities inherent to the ship are the Obelisk Swarmers and the Cascade Emitter, which you can only get with the Advanced Obelisk. The real benefit of this carrier is that it's a tank. So I hope that that helped somebody out there, gave them some information to look at the ship. And in our next video, of course, we'll do the Borg and we'll see how it does against them, and then the Voth. So, and then we'll conclude with what I think of this carrier. And then after that, we'll go on to the next series of ships. So thank you all for watching and stay tuned for the next.